if you look over here, you'll see three case segments. These are three of the five pieces that will be used for the DM-3 static tank. The fourth is behind this yellow door here. It's going to come out here in a few minutes to be put in one of these pits. So we have four of the five here. The fifth one, which is the aft segment, is still in clear field and will show up next week and we'll start working it.
I'm here with Paul Carner, and we're standing in front of this massive mock-up of the... Paul, I'm going to let you... Paul, you tell me what
we're looking at. You bet. Yeah, right, Jason. This is a mock-up of the new launch vehicle for NASA, the Ares, and what this is allowing us to do here is get in and check a bunch of stuff out electrically and make sure it's working so that when we go and fly it for the first time, it flies right and we know where it's going. We got a lot of great stuff going on, a lot of software, a lot of firmware, a lot of integration activities that... It's just been a real quick for all of us to be able to work on and to be able to be part of this human spaceflight effort. This is what will help steer the rocket and get it to the point in space that it needs as we get those astronauts up there. It's an absolute blast. We're getting paid to do it.
As an intern, a volunteer, and a journalist, I can say this is the closest to one of these that's going to fire the next day that I've ever been. And it's a little intimidating. It's got all these tubes sticking in it and out of it. It's got caution signs everywhere. It's got instrumentation to record data strapped all around it. It is just a very impressive looking piece of equipment, and I'm sure tomorrow it's going to give us one heck of a show. You're good. I got a NASA guy. Here's from Marshall. This is Dan. Dan, say hi.
I'm freezing. I can't say hi. It's cold in here.
Okay, we've just left the DM-2 building. It's nice to be outside at 50 degrees. And we're taking a look at the equipment used to keep the inside cool. Now, I'm not sure you can hear me. I hope that you can. But if you look at that pipe, it's white. That's not because they paint it white or some coolant. That's because that's ice. That is ice. Check that out. That's how cold it is. I got it in there. I'm frozen over.
Right, although your technical terminology was fabulous, what's behind us is the CO2 quench arm. And what that does is once we're done firing, we need to cool the motor down. So that quench arm will swing around and that end.
Right.
We'll go ahead and move into the motor, and the CO2 goes in there and helps cool the motor down. What we want to make sure to do is stop the engine from burning or the motor from burning so that we can preserve the data. So we want to see how it is. So that's a very important part of our test.
They are currently doing the go-no-go for test. You can see they have a countdown clock over there. And this place is packed. Officials, astronauts. Packed, racked, and stashed into the Utah countryside.
It's like shooting into the sun.
10, 9, 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, fire. Plus 5.
this motor obviously is designed as a 5-segment motor. It produces about 3.6 million pounds of thrust, which is equivalent to about 22,000 horsepower. So it's just an incredible amount of force and energy that's unleashed in this. What's interesting, one of the interesting details is DM-1, we did it what we call ambient. It was about 80 degrees.
Right.
The test we did today was at 40 degrees. So when we do that, we lose about 80,000 pounds of thrust. And that's one of the reasons we test under hot and cold conditions, so that we can understand how they play into the trajectory.
Now, Alex, you're pulling all these numbers just out of thin air. Are they off the top of your head?
I do have a cheat sheet, but I try.
Oh, come on. Look at that. The NASA guy has got a cheat sheet.
No. Actually, my cheat sheet's got old numbers on it, so I didn't pull it out today. It's got DM-1 numbers, and I had to pull it out the other day and said, this won't work for today, so we're giving you today's
number. Final question. Okay, so the first one was ambient at 83. The second one was cold at 40, and the next one was supposed to be hot. Now,
yes.
Will they raise the temperature?
Yes. We will take the same building, and we brought refrigeration units in to cool this one down to 40. We will fire the next one at 90 degrees.
90 degrees.
And so we'll actually get extra energy out of the system. And today, it's interesting, DM-1 burned for about 120 seconds. Today's, when we go cold, it burned for 125 to 126 seconds, which is where we were today. And you'll go the opposite direction, and you'll be
right.
A little shorter than 120 seconds when we do the hot mix.
So if you look at the physics of putting something in space, you have to get to this magic speed of 17,500 miles per hour.
Right.
So the question becomes, what's the best way to do that? And it turns out, if you take a look at the launch profile, that the most efficient launch profile uses a combination of both solids and liquids. In the first stage, or down low, you want to use a solid rocket motor because it has much higher thrust to weight ratio than a liquid motor does. Once you get up higher and you get some speed underneath you, then it's much better to transition to actually to a liquid motor for two reasons. One, it's a higher efficient motor, and number two, you can actually target a speed to cut off the motor, whereas a solid motor, you have to wait till it burns out. So that's the physics behind it, and that's the theory behind it. And if that's true, then we ought to be able to go look at launch vehicles around the world and see if, in fact, that's what they do. And amazingly, when we go canvas what is out there in the world today, almost all the rockets that are out there today use some form of solid on the first stage, whether
right.
It's a strap-on solid like you see on some of the heavy lifts or the deltas of the Atlas. And then they use a liquid upper stage. The Japanese
right.
do it, the Europeans do it, the
yep.
Americans do it because the laws of physics dictate it. So the point is, you need both. You need a heavy lift, I mean, you need solids down low, and then you need liquids up high.
I'm going to do this for my producer. It'll make him happy. Mike, what is your favorite orbiter? Of all the orbiters, which one is your favorite?
I flew Atlantis twice, and so that is my favorite.